Hello, and welcome back to Wine Reform. So today we're going to talk about our second grape in our Wines Around the World segment. Now, wine has been grown in Germany for over 2,000 years, or rather, wine grapes have been grown in Germany for over 2,000 years. So let's take a look at their most iconic grape, Riesling. It was first written down by Hieronymus Bock. He was a German botanist, physician, and Lutheran minister, and he's not to be confused with Hieronymus Bosch, the painter. And he first wrote about Riesling in his book, Herbal, in 1552. Now, Riesling is a really cool white grape. It prefers cooler climates, and it develops really high acidity. But it's also extremely susceptible to something called noble rot. Noble rot is basically a fungus that can attach to grapes, and it kind of punctures the skin, which allows a lot of the water to evaporate out from it, which concentrates those sugars. And noble rot tends to happen in climates with a bit more fog, maybe a bit more moisture, and it's actually not a bad thing when used sparingly. So because of this susceptibility that Riesling has to noble rot, it can make wines that are all the way from dry to very sweet. So we mentioned that Riesling is a white grape and it's super duper neat, and it has a wide range of expression. Now, it can go from tasting very appley and lemony and limey all the way to apricot and mango and pineapple and peach to even dried apricot and dried stone fruit. And the best Rieslings can bottle age really well and develop flavors of honey and petroleum. So Riesling is grown all over the world, anywhere that's around the 50 degree latitude on the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere, and sometimes even a bit north, at least on the northern hemisphere, even a bit north of that 50 degree latitude mark. It's grown in Germany, France, the US, Australia, New Zealand, and Austria. But we are looking at German Riesling. So German wines have a super duper logical labeling convention that can help the consumer pick exactly what kind of wine they're looking for. So you're gonna know what's in the bottle based on what's on that label. And we just need to break it down. So it's divided up by levels of ripeness because it's very difficult to get grapes to ripen in cooler climates. And I would say that this is a bit of a pyramid of quality, really. So right at the bottom, we have Landwein. Now, Landwein is wine made from grapes anywhere in Germany, and the wines are usually very light-bodied and very dry, so kind of, you know, run-of-the-mill, easy-drinking kind of stuff, not very expensive. So next up, Qualitätswein. Now, this wine is made from grapes grown anywhere in the 13 German wine regions, and I'll pop them up on the screen. So these grapes are riper than the ones used in Landwein. After Landwein and Qualitätswein, there's Prädikatswein. These grapes are even riper. So from here on out, every grape subdivision is part of the Prädikatswein category, and they do get riper and riper from there. So the lowest of the Prädikatswein is Cabernet, and Cabernet is just slightly riper, but it kind of sounds like cabinet wine, so wine you just keep in your house and you drink whenever, even though it's much better quality. And above Cabernet is Spätlese. And Spätlese means late harvest. And this means that the grapes were picked later in the growing season to sort of concentrate those sugars and flavors and acids to make, a fuller body wine than the Cabernet wine. Above Spätlese is Auslese, and Auslese means select harvest. So this means that the grapes were picked not from a whole slew of vines, but the bunches themselves were selected by hand. And after the Auslese is Eiswein. So many of you have probably heard of it. It's getting harder and harder to achieve as the world warms up. But Eiswein is ice wine. This means that the grapes are picked in the dead of night when they are frozen on the vine, and they're pressed while still frozen to really ensure a concentration of sugars and acids and flavor. So, after Eiswein, we have Baden. Now, this means selected berry harvest. That means that the wine made from these grapes have been affected by that noble rot, and they've been handpicked grape by grape. After Baden, there's trockenbären Erschlüsse. And this means selected dried berry harvest. So these wines are made from grapes that have been so affected by that noble rot that the grapes almost seem dried. And they are also selected grape by grape. So something else that's really cool is that German wines are not only labeled by this pyramid of quality, but they're also labeled by their sweetness level. So if you see trocken on a bottle, that means it's gonna be a dry wine. And if you see halbtrocken, it means it's gonna be half dry wine, so probably off dry. And oftentimes on the back of, on the back labels of German wines, you're gonna see like a meter, and it's gonna have, it's a sweetness scale, and it'll go all the way from dry to sweet, and it'll show you where that wine sits on that sweetness scale, so you know exactly what you're getting. So much information, super duper neat, and honestly, if you want to understand exactly what you're getting when it comes to a wine, I highly recommend selecting a German wine. Once you understand their labeling system, you know exactly what you're getting. So today, we are trying Schmitt Riesling. So this wine is labeled as the 2019 Riesling Qualitätswein Rheinhessen. And what that means is that it is part of the Qualitätswein level on that pyramid of quality. So we are above Landwein, but we haven't gotten to the Prädikatswein categories, which means that it doesn't get any of those special subdivisions indicating its level of ripeness. So this is probably more like a table wine. And Rheinhessen is one of the 13 German wine regions, so we know that all the Riesling grapes that have been used in this wine are from Rheinhessen. Now, the Schmitt family has been making wine since 1919, and they've had a vineyard since even before that, but it wasn't until 1984 that they took their operation worldwide, and now they are worldly recognized, so super duper cool. Now, what's even more awesome about that is because they understand that their audience is from all around the world, not just Germany, they have on their website a breakdown of how to read a German wine label, along with a lot of other really good information on German wine that can help the average consumer kind of, you know, dip their toes in. So I highly recommend checking out their website, and I'll drop it in the description. So I went to my local liquor outlet, and I only spent $9.99 on this bottle. Now, as you can see, it says 33% more. So this is more than the typical 750 milliliter bottle of wine. It's a liter. This is a whole liter of wine. Okay, that's a lot. And we know that a liter is 1,000 milliliters. So thanks, metric system, you make a lot more sense. So I'd say that's actually, it's a pretty darn affordable wine. So you know what, why don't we give it a try and see if it is good for what you're getting. So I'm gonna open this and we'll get to the tasting. Got it open. I've lowered the camera a little so that you can see, maybe not me, but more of what's happening with this wine. So let's give it a pour. And that's plenty. So the first thing we do when we are evaluating a wine is we look at it. Got my handy dandy white sheet of paper. I'm gonna fold it in half for easier handling. And we'll take a look at the appearance of our Riesling. I'm looking at it now, and it is so absolutely pale. Kind of like the Acidotico, this Riesling is almost watery in color. There's the faintest of lemon yellow, but honestly, it looks like it has almost no body. The clarity is impeccable. And I'm expecting an extremely light-bodied wine out of this. And we're back. So we just evaluated the appearance of the wine. The next thing you do when you are evaluating a wine, after you've given it a good look-see, is you give it a sniff. So right off the bat, the intensity is very faint. I had to work kind of hard to get the aroma out of this, and I suppose that's to be expected out of a Qualitätswein, since I'm not in the Produktswein levels yet. Although, when I did get aroma, it was a bit faint, like a bit pear-like, and I also got some lemon and whetstone. So I did get three aromas out of it, even though it was a very, well, not a very intense aroma. So I suppose that's to be expected because I spent about $10 on a liter of wine, but let's go ahead and give it a taste. So first sip to prime the palate and then the second sip to evaluate. Let's go. Oh, okay. So thank goodness I didn't pass judgment right away. It's actually very pleasantly refreshing. So right off the bat, the first thing I tasted on my tongue was a bit of kumquat. It's kind of a sweet and sour acidity to it. It wasn't quite lemony. It definitely had a softer acidity or softer citrusy note. And I tasted a fresh, crisp apple. And then a little bit of that granite, like whetstone kind of flavor. So actually extremely pleasant. The acidity was very high, which is what made it so refreshing. And I definitely felt that on the sides of my tongue and it made me salivate a little. The alcohol is so low. I could barely feel it. This is a wine that you can drink at lunch and have no problems. Yep, it's only 9.5% alcohol by volume, so that explains why the alcohol didn't feel very strong. And honestly, if you want Riesling, you're not gonna find a lot of German Rieslings that are higher in alcohol. They tend to kind of be around that range. The finish was very short, and it was actually extremely pleasant. I can see myself enjoying this wine sort of in warmer months especially. It's not very heavy, it's very light bodied, it's very high acidity, it's very balanced, and it has a short finish. So it's really, it's not a wine that you would usually savor by itself. It's more one of those like drink by the pool kind of wines. I think I would pair this with some light foods that have a good zing to them. So I think that if you're gonna have spicy food, this would complement that very well. Because there's not very high alcohol, and even though the acidity is high, there's enough sweetness to balance it out. I do think that you could drink this with a spicy meal and not set your mouth on fire. I do see this going very well with a lot of, again, traditional German fare. If you've ever had a good old fashioned, what's it called? The thing, it's fried, it's like a fried cutlet, and you drizzle lemon on top, and you have sauerkraut on the side, and you probably eat it with potatoes. What is that called? I can't remember. Yeah, I think that this is a very food-friendly wine, actually, as long as that food is light. I think the size of this bottle just makes me think of, like, art school. And it kind of makes me crave the unholy marriage of Bauhaus and Bavaria. So I decided to, well, try to make that unholy marriage happen. When I have two very different ideas and I like to combine them, I turn to collage. Now, collage doesn't have to be paper and glue. It can be paper, glue, fabric, thread, paint, ink, pencil, photo. Honestly, if you can combine it, it's collage. But I'm just using what I have at my disposal. I found a lot of really cool imagery from Bavarian folk art. And I gotta say, it is incredible the amount of stylized detail you can find in that beautiful craft. And I also pulled a lot of imagery from the Bauhaus. I highly recommend checking out the Triadic Ballet. Oh, and yeah, I pulled out some imagery from Herbal. You know, that book by Hieronymus Bock. Sometimes if you want to see something different, you have to turn it on its head, or on its side, or just flip it around entirely. You never know what you'll discover. You know, I've noticed that the color yellow is either you love it or you hate it. Lucky for me, I love it. And don't worry, if you don't know what's going on here, I didn't either. I was just going with the flow. At this point, I had made a sufficient mess, if you will. But I think that sometimes you need to. Do you think that the people of the Bauhaus drank the same wine that people of Bavaria do? I like to think that. I like to think that wine is a bit of culture that can, well, join us. And yes, I'm using more yellow. It feels really good to just not care and make some ugly art. Cheers!
Thank you for joining me for this episode of Wine Reform. Yeah, I highly recommend everybody try a Schmitt-Sohn Riesling. They have a huge range of quality in terms of their Riesling, but this one, their 2019 Riesling Qualitätswein Rheinhessen, is a really good, it's a good casual wine. Yeah, if you liked what you saw, be sure to give me a thumbs up. If you haven't done so already, be sure to subscribe. I release videos every Friday, and God forbid I miss a day, hit the bell icon, and is it on, well, I think subscribe and the bell, yeah, hit the bell icon somewhere next to the subscribe button, and you will be notified when I do release the video. And hey, drop a comment. Have you ever had a Riesling before, and what did you think of it? I'm genuinely curious. Like, let's talk about wine. As always, it's been a pleasure. And I will see you guys next week. Bye-bye.